This is Chase Broussard. I'm the president of DealMakers out of Houston, Texas.
Chase Broussard, DealMakers out of Houston, Texas. Welcome to the Crude Life. How's life going today?
It's going great, man. It's a Tuesday. I'm live on a phone call with you, and we're discussing what I love the most and have a passion for, the industry, oil and gas.
Yeah, we kind of had a little sidebar conversation about our passion. We were a couple of energy enthusiasts. I explained mine, which is the whole capitalism side, the whole developing culture side, even to the point of, you know, I believe what's going on right now is going to be read about in history books by our kids' kids and our grandkids, et cetera. So what is it that you like to tell people when it comes to why are you such an energy enthusiast and why do you have so much passion for the oil and gas industry?
I kind of like to explain it for those who like muscle cars, right? I flowed wells for a living. I literally took the raw material out of the ground and passed it through equipment that I since consider myself an expert of, and got to separate that and see how it functions in society from this. Like, I'm looking at this calculator right here. It's made of plastic. There's oil in this. You know, it's in everything.
That is neat, isn't it? How it not only powers our lives, but it is in so many different things. And the whole capitalism side and the whole developing of cultures is really neat when it comes to the energy industry. Talk to me a little bit about how you got involved with the energy industry. Were you born into it? Are you second generation? Or did you come out of a different industry and then get into that through that particular industry, like we're finding a lot of engineers and tech people are today? How did you get into the industry?
So when I was a senior in high school, I was 18 years old, and I started working for what was National Oil Well at the time, which is now National Oil Well Barco. And I was just a regular old mechanic helper working around the shop, you know, making my way to try to get into an industry because I was graduating soon. Well, that didn't pan out. I ended up joining the military. And once I got out the military, I got back into it because I guess you could say I'm a generation, second generation, because all of my family is in the oil field one way or another. And I just followed their footsteps after serving my country.
Chase Broussard, DealMakers, you said serving your country. Thank you for your service. What part of the military were you in?
I was in the Army for 7 years, 10 months.
Did that prepare you? When I interviewed Brian Lash from Target Logistics, the military was a big client of his with the man camps or the, I forget, crew camps are called now, and that sort of thing. How was the transition from oil and gas and military? A lot of people say it is very similar nowadays versus how it was, you know, 20 years ago. You got the stories of the roughneck slinging chains and everything, but nowadays they almost say like a lot of the, you know, the different oil and gas sites very much reflect how the military infrastructure is done.
100% agree with you on that. It's a brotherhood, right? And I don't want to say it like a sexist, but like it's a brother sisterhood thing, right? Because in the military, you have guys and gals, but when you come together and you all share the same common goal, whether it's serving your country together, right, or you're out serving your company, right, and the industry by working at the well sites, and you develop a camaraderie. You're with those guys more than you're with your family, so to speak, and it's similar in nature because of those small aspects, you know, where you're out and about on a daily basis with these guys, and they're from all walks of life, people you meet from all walks of life, but it's a small world, just like in the military. You're running to people, you're like, man, I served as you in this country, and, you know, they're in a different job title or a different, they're with a different business, you know?
Chase Broussard, DealMakers. It's interesting about your background when it comes to the energy and then, of course, the military, and now, you know, you're working DealMakers. Talk to me a little bit about that company and how that is that you're, you know, it sounds to me like you're able to talk very well within people in the industry. So talk to me about your customers, who are your customers, and what it is you're doing for them currently.
So my number one customer is XRI Blue. They're a company out of Midland, Odessa. And I have a number of other companies, J6 Energy Services, I'm working with, I've worked with Halliburton and Fashion, Bill and anything. I'm working with private equity groups. I'm actually working with, I'm getting ready to work with an oil company and to help them raise funds for some big projects upcoming. And how I got into this, I guess it's just who I am, right? I make deals. That's what I do. I'm a salesman. And I'm proud of it. I'm very proud of who I am as a salesman. And my goal when I opened up my business was to build equipment, right? But opening a business with the minimum cash flow, and I looked at the business up and I said, you know what, in order for me to do this, I'm going to have to X amount of cash, and I'm just coming out into the industry to try to be, you know, an entrepreneur, so I got to find a way to do it. Well, how do you build a business? You got to have sales. So I developed DealMakers because I was told by a very successful CEO who I worked right underneath, and he took me under his wing, and he's my mentor today, Joe Campo Feliz. He told me, you know, hey, you're good at making deals. Go make them, you know. Go put them together. Go make deals. And they laid me off, and it was the most boring thing that a CEO could have told me, because guess what I did? I embraced that, and I ran with it. And as we sit here today, I'm very successful. I 7X'd my company last year on my first year of business, so things are going great, man.
I think that's fantastic. I remember talking to a guy in the Bakken, up in the Bakken oil fields, in its early days there, where I said, man, somebody could just make a living figuring out deals for different companies, networking different people together, because these energy companies and the midstream companies, they had new problems. And not only new problems, but because there was a new generation of people, the trying to vet and trying to figure out who they could trust and who they couldn't trust became a commodity out there.
That's a good point, man. I mean, that's so true. I faced it. But you know what? You know what? You know how you win that? You just be a real person. You be a real. You got to be real. You can't be showing the people that you're dealing with. You can't constantly show them that, oh, it's the shady things that go on within industries. It's not just the oil and gas industry. You, whatever you say, right, all you have in this world is your word, man. You got to stand behind who you are, your name, and your word. You've got to do that. And I embrace that. So I can relate to what you're saying, man. The vetting process is amazing. I embrace that vetting process without even realizing it.
But at the same time, like how, you know, there's natural born detectives and there's natural born athletes and there's all these other things. It sounds to me like your pedigree has prepared you for this, because doing what you do, the average person couldn't do. I mean, you grew up, like you said, all the way back to high school, you started being introduced to the energy industry. So you've got a very formidable time of your life that was energy influenced. And then, you know, you talked about the military, same thing. And then that, of course, like we talked about earlier with the context, much of the oil and gas industry is very militaristic now in terms of the kind of the protocols and the infrastructures and a lot of those different things, you know. Do you try to go to a well site just unannounced? It ain't happening. It is not happening. So, but so what I'm getting at is that it seems to me that you've been able to figure out a way to make a living in the oil and gas industry based on who you are and what the industry needs, that not everybody can do. So congratulations to that. What type of a reaction are you getting from people? Because it is a new concept, but at the same time, it's the oldest concept there is.
Well, most people don't have a problem with it. I'll tell you this. The companies that love my services are the companies that don't have the time to continuously search and look for opportunities when they're purchasing, right? Their purchasing power is there and it operates, but I'm in a different aspect. I go and find the deals because that's what my business is to find the best deal for my customer. So in return, their service is connected and they have what they need and it closes out through me. And they remember me as an individual rather than all of the different fabricators and all the different other vendors that they have to deal with. And quite frankly, I'm not, those fabricators and those other vendors, they don't mind that I'm in the space. They want to work with me because they know that I'm going to bring that same, I'm going to bring that to them. I'm going to bring the revenue to them because I need them just like they need me, right? And, I mean, at the end of the day, I'm just real. Some fabricators don't want to pay sales teams, right? They don't want to pay it because they know it's an overhead cost. And I'm eliminating that for some of the fabrication shops I'm working with. So it's a win-win for everyone.
That's exactly right. When you were talking about your business model just there, all I could think of is this friend of mine who left a very nice, large company in the Midwest, and she started a project management company, which I thought, that is genius. How many people need good quality project managers, just like people need good quality salespeople, because the amount of labor that one can go through before they find somebody of quality can nearly bankrupt a company at times. So it's
absolutely, yeah, man, $150,000 a year before you know it, then you got all the costs associated with the projects that they're managing. You know what I mean?
Oh, without a doubt, without a doubt. I mean, that's like old in the old media world. They used to do a draw, meaning that they'll give you a couple grand a month, but until you produce a couple grand in sales, you ain't even gonna get above that part, you know. And so,
absolutely, I sold cars for a living right when I got out of the army, waiting for the auto to pick up, man. I know what you mean. Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Well, I think this is great because I think what you're doing is ahead of its time, which is actually current. They say the future is now. But like I was saying, the project management side of things, me actually branching to the whole content creation side, which is a specialized part too. And then, you know, you've got yourself going in the sales side of things. I do see where professionals are really able to find a little niche business for themselves. And with the social media, the wired world we live in, they're able to really grow their business at a nice, manageable rate. And a lot of times that was a problem when they were with companies, that the company wanted to either grow too fast or they didn't understand how to embrace change to grow. This way a person can grow at their own pace and, like you said earlier, be honest to their client and say, I can't take that on right now, or, you know, we could take on a lot more, because there is a lot to be said about honest communication and that sort of thing. So kudos to you, man. I'm floored that it's working out for you, and I wish you luck, and I can't wait to hear about more things down the line a little bit. So talk to me about a little bit, you know, last final thoughts, if you will, a little bit. Kind of give me your sales pitch and what you like to tell customers, and kind of final thoughts that you like to leave people. Last word, if you will.
If you're looking for equipment within the industry, please give me an opportunity, because if it's there, I will find it.